So now I'd like to welcome Laura Jimenez, the Director of the College and Career Readiness and Success Center, for some welcoming remarks and introductions of our presenters.
Thank you, Jennifer. For those of you who might not be familiar with the CCRS Center, we are one of seven content centers funded by the Department of Education to provide technical assistance support to state education agencies. We focus on supporting states in the implementation of their college and career readiness and success initiatives. We do this work in close collaboration with regional comprehensive centers who directly support a set of states in their region on different education reform initiatives. Together, we provide customized support that facilitates the continuous design, implementation, and improvement of state CCRS priorities. Some of the work that we do with our state and regional center partners includes providing technical assistance to states, including written responses to specific college and career readiness and success questions, direct technical assistance and facilitation of workshops or trainings, and acting as a thought partner and conceptual peer to a state. We also work to make our technical assistance experiences more broadly applicable by developing products based on state priorities. These products include briefs and tools that are intended to help build knowledge on a particular topic, guides that facilitate state teams through a particular process, and professional learning modules, which are training materials that can be customized and adapted by stakeholders. Crucial to all of this work, whether it is providing technical assistance support or the development of products, is to understand what work is going on in different states and the nuanced context of the states in which we work. In an effort to best target our materials, we have focused on three main focal areas. These include measures and outcomes, accountability, and career pathways. More specifically, measures and outcomes relates to the question, how do you know when students are ready for success in college and careers? Accountability is about how to use measures at the state and local level to improve student outcomes in meeting college and career readiness and success goals. The third area, career pathways, is about ensuring that there are coherent, clear, and articulated pathways from the K-12, post-secondary, and workforce systems that connect student interests and skills to a career. The work that we are highlighting today, the Career Pathways Facilitator's Guide, fits under this larger umbrella of career pathways and is designed as a tool to walk state education agencies through the process of designing, implementing, and evaluating career pathways statewide initiatives. As you can see here, today's webinar will discuss the importance of career pathways, as well as provide examples of what career pathways work looks like at the state and local levels. Then we will introduce our latest resource, the Career Pathways Facilitator's Guide, and review how we can support state educational agencies in using this resource. Today, I am joined by a great lineup of presenters who I will briefly introduce in the order they will be speaking. Sharon Lee Miller serves as the Director of the Division of Academic and Technical Education within the U.S. Department of Education's Office of Career and Adult Technical Education. Her office is responsible for administering the grants under the Carl D. Perkins Career and Technical Education Act of 2006. To discuss the comprehensive effort to build career pathways across education and workforce agencies in Ohio, we will be joined by Ryan Burgess, the Director of Governor Kasich's Office of Workforce Transformation, and Carolyn George, the Career Connections Administrator at the Ohio Department of Education. Cynthia Bader, Program Administrator of Link Learning at Long Beach Unified School District in California, will be sharing how her district has built career pathways for all students with support from the state of California. Finally, Jamar Nellum, Senior Technical Assistance Consultant, and David Blumenthal, researcher, both of the CCRS Center, will close out the webinar by discussing our recently released Career Pathways Facilitator's Guide. I now invite Sharon to provide her remarks.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Jennifer, and thank you, Laura, for the invitation to present on this webinar. As Laura said, my name is Sharon Miller. I'm the Director of the Division of Academic and Technical Education at the U.S. Department of Education, and I'm pleased to be with you here today to share some of our work pertaining to career pathways. At the federal level, we have been at this work for many years in some form or fashion, probably since the school-to-work days of the 1990s. In those days, the ideas of making education relevant to the workplace and connecting school and work really took hold. Integration of academic and technical education, work-based learning, and employability skills all became increasingly popular, both for students, regardless whether they would enter work or post-secondary education after high school. In the early 2000s, school-to-work approaches may have taken a little bit of a backseat to the common core, but gave even more prominence to the integration of academic and technical education, dual and concurrent enrollment, and technical skills assessments, all of which are part of career pathways approaches. Over the past few years, all this work has now taken shape in what is being termed the career pathways approach. There's no one way of building career pathways, but all of the efforts have basic common elements. They connect education, training, and supportive services to create a holistic approach to serving the wide range of students that we serve, from students in high school to disconnected youth to incumbent workers trying to advance in their careers to adults entering education, perhaps for the first time in many years. They lead to marketable skills and credentials, many in a stackable fashion to meet state, regional, and local workforce demands. Overall, the goal is to strengthen and grow our nation's workforce, as well as to ensure that all individuals have the opportunity to secure an in-demand job that leads to economic self-sufficiency and prosperity. In a sign that career pathways approaches have really taken root in our nation, the recently enacted Workforce Innovation and Opportunities Act, or WIOA, includes in Section 3 a definition for career pathways. A few items to note regarding the definition. It's focused on state and regional economic demands, meaning that business and industry must play a central role. It calls for the full range of education, training, and supportive services to meet the education and career goals of every individual, meaning that secondary and post-secondary teachers, faculty, counselors, and other individuals must work together to coordinate services. It encourages concurrent enrollment and opportunities for acceleration along the pathway, again, requiring key individuals to work together to develop appropriate courses. And it culminates in tangible diplomas, degrees, certifications, and licensures that help an individual enter and advance within a chosen career. As previously stated, there is not one set way to approach the work of developing career pathways. Some are doing this work at the state level, some at the regional level, some at the local level. Some are doing it by career cluster area, some by sector area, some pathway by pathways. Some are doing this work by focusing on a specific population, like adults or individuals in the juvenile justice system. No one way of doing this work is preferable. At the same time, all the approaches to this work share some common elements. These elements were described in a letter that was issued back in 2012 by the U.S. Department of Education, Labor, and Health and Human Services. The next slide shares those elements and the subsequent work that has been or is being undertaken by the federal agencies, which you will see has grown from 3 agencies in 2012 to now 13 agencies and counting today. On this slide are the 6 key elements of a career pathway. The elements begin by building partnerships across key education, workforce, and economic development agencies at the state, regional, or local level. Next, using labor market data to identify the key industry sectors or career areas on which to focus. At this stage, key employers in those sectors are brought in to clarify the vision, goals, standards, and expectations for programs. Education and training programs are then identified, perhaps having to be built from the ground up in the case of new or emerging career areas. From there, funding and other resources are developed, policies, funding and other resources are developed, programs and policies are systematically and progressively aligned, and measures to gauge system change and student outcomes are established. Each of these elements are more thoroughly described in a recently developed toolkit by the U.S. Department of Labor, the cover for which is provided on the slide. It's a Career Pathways Toolkit, a guide for system development. One of the important points about a career pathways approach is that the goal is to create a system of opportunities for youth and adults. I liken this, and I've heard other people liken this, to the federal transportation systems of interstates and highways and streets and roads. Sometimes there are bridges and overpasses, there are entrances and exits. The only difference is that there are no wrong way, please turn back signs. The whole system is designed to take people from where they are to where they need to go, whether a short distance or a far distance, with the most direct and unobstructed route. Our goal is to develop that system and undertake maintenance and upgrades where needed. The work in my office, Career and Technical Education, or Perkins, and on the other side of the house, Adult Education, is to build out the part of the system that connects in-school youth and adults to the system, the career pathway system, that is. We also do some work with out-of-school youth and disconnected youth and adults, mostly in partnerships with our colleagues at the Department of Labor. For our work, we have developed what we are calling the integrated model for CTE, which provides a visual for how individuals progress along a career path. In the middle part of the visual, you can see how the program builds as students seek stackable credentials for jobs that progress through high school. As we have mentioned, individuals can enter and exit and re-enter the pathway as their education, career, and personal needs dictate. Our office has been using this model in our national initiatives that we have been hosting for states. This is a screenshot of our Perkins Collaborative Resource Network, or PCRN, where we provide information on all our projects. I call your attention to three specific efforts. First, as previously mentioned, the Department of Education, Labor, and Health and Human Services came together in 2012 to craft a letter that contains the federal vision for career pathways. I encourage you to view that letter if you've not done so already. Second, we just completed a technical assistance with project with five states, shown on the slide, and produced four deliverables that you may find helpful in your own work. Among the deliverables is a tool for sustaining career pathways efforts once they have been developed, refunding, retooling, and otherwise rejiggering the pathways to meet new workforce and student demands is always needed. Finally, for those of you who might be considering work in the transportation sector, we produce a document in partnership with the Department of Labor that projects future employment, skills gaps, and training needs within the transportation industry and its subsectors over the next 10 years. Again, I encourage you to take a look. In closing, I wanted to let you know about two of our efforts that are now underway. First, we're updating the Dear Colleague letter that I just spoke about before to reflect commitment now from 13 agencies that are working together across the federal government to promote career pathway approaches. We expect that letter is going to be issued within the coming weeks. Second, we're implementing a second round of technical assistance regarding career pathways for states. As in our prior effort, we'll be offering coaching from nationally recognized experts, regional and national meetings, and topical papers. We will also be seeking to identify a cadre of state leaders who can be deployed to help others, whether in their state or nationally, implement career pathways. We will also be developing a playbook or a step-by-step guide for state leaders to mobilize key stakeholders toward career pathway system development. We hope you'll stay tuned for announcements about these initiatives in the coming months. The Department of Education looks forward to being a partner with you along the journey to develop career pathways for our nation's youth and adults. We hope you'll stay connected through one or all or more of the sites that are on your screen. With that, I turn the presentation back over to Laura. Thank you.
Thanks, Sharon, and Laura is also joining us. Laura, we had a great question about how does the recent release CCRS Center Facilitator's Guide mentioned complement some of the other tools that the federal interagencies Career Pathways has released, some of the tools that Sharon mentioned as well.
Thanks, Jennifer. Yes, I'd be happy to answer that. I do think what the CCRS Center has produced is a really nice companion because it speaks to all of the same elements that the recently released federal tools speak to, such as engaging employers and other stakeholders, conducting a labor market analysis. And what our tool does is it provides a step-by-step guide that states can use and even other agencies can use to walk through each of these steps. We have a facilitator's guide with talking points and slides, handouts, and other supplementary resources. So I do believe that our tool complements what's already out there because it helps states and other agencies and partners walk through very similar processes and steps that the federal guides do.
Great, and I know you're previewing some of your colleagues' future presentation, so just a note to the audience to stay tuned to hear about the details of the facilitator's guide that's forthcoming. Sharon, we had a question for you. You specifically shared the definition for career pathways that is embedded in the WIOA legislation, but folks are wondering if that definition is has been or will be adopted within the other agencies that you mentioned that are part of the effort. Is everyone sort of operating from the same page in terms of a definition these days?
So, yes, that is our hope. I mean, you know, a lot of those agencies also have programs that are funded under WIOA, so those agencies for sure are following that definition. And then in our work, you know, as we're getting ready and gearing up for Perkins reauthorization, we are also going back to that WIOA career pathways definition, and we hope that is also the basis of our legislation so that we can all kind of get on board, you know, in terms of the same, you know, lexicon that we're using for this work. Again, recognizing that how it rolls out in states, regions, and local communities, you know, may be vastly different, but we think that these basic elements of a career pathways and for high quality education and training are the same in all of our work across, you know, all federal agencies and the populations we serve.
Fabulous, thanks. And throughout your presentation, you mentioned a lot of emphasis on some special populations, particularly the disconnected youth population. Could you speak to whether or not there will be future tools, either coming from the CCRS Center or the U.S. Department of Education, specifically to think about career pathways for that population? Sharon, why don't you take that question first, and then Laura.
So, that's a fabulous question. We have right now an interagency partnership on youth initiatives that's focusing on disconnected youth, and we've also started a what's called a P3 a partnership pilot project, and a part of those projects we're going to be doing some technical assistance, and we are planning to do some resources that would be specific on disconnected youth and career pathways. So I don't have exact timelines for deliverables, but I would say I can share, you know, more information as I have, you know, better timeframes for when those would be issued.
Thanks, and Laura, do you have anything to add?
I do. So we are always in a process of continuous improvement and refinement of our tools and resources. And as we deploy this particular tool with state educational agencies, we will be customizing it. And if speaking more directly to the needs of disconnected youth is something that they would be interested in doing, we could customize the tool in real time. And depending on how the technical assistance activity then goes, we would certainly be open to building a supplementary tool that would speak directly to the needs of disconnected youth. So I would encourage those of you who are on this webinar interested in doing this work, particularly for that student group, please get in contact with us and let us know, and we'd be happy to work with you.
Thanks so much, and please know we will be sharing all the contact information for the presenters today, as well as links to all of the tools and resources that people have been mentioned, both throughout the webinar, and we will be sure to have those posted on our resource page, both on the AYPF website and the CCRS Center website. So thanks for all your great questions from the audience, but we're going to move on to our next presentation, and so I'd like to invite Ryan Burgess and Carolyn George from Ohio to join us and tell us about their efforts in Ohio.
Great. Thank you, Jennifer. Appreciate the opportunity to speak with you today. Before I go into the state's combined plan, I'd like to first explain the Office of Workforce Transformation's role. Governor Kasich, when he came into office, created the office with the recognition that the workforce system was fragmented and siloed. Just at the state level alone, there are 13 agencies with over 90 programs that impact workforce development. So we are charged with ensuring Ohio's workforce system follows four main tenets. And Jennifer, if you could advance the slide there. First, everything we do, we're driven by the needs of business. Businesses are the ones that create the jobs, so we want to make sure we are aligned with their needs. Second, we want to be adaptive to rapid change. As we all know, Uber didn't exist a couple years ago, and we need to be able to adjust to those type of changes in our global economy. Thirdly, we want to be innovative and integrated in our design and delivery, and I think our combined state plan really captures that. And finally, we want to be entrepreneurial in spirit. We want to take advantage of opportunities when they present themselves. Jennifer, next slide, please. So we began this work in 2012 with the vision of creating a unified workforce system by better connecting programs and services. By strategically aligning the programs, we can assist employers find the workers they need to succeed and grow their businesses while helping students and job seekers access the information and skills training they need to compete for in-demand jobs in Ohio. In 2014, we worked with a diverse group of state and local stakeholders to develop the state's first unified workforce plan that incorporated major workforce programs to conform with the Workforce Investment Act. Jennifer, next slide, please. Today, the combined state plan built upon all of that work to encourage collaboration among education, job training, and career exploration programs. Ohio's combined state plan aligns the state's largest workforce programs under one strategic vision, and you can see those on that slide. In developing this plan, we work with the Ohio Departments of Aging, Education, Higher Education, Jobs and Family Services, and Opportunities for Ohioans with Disabilities to ensure coordination of workforce services. It's truly been a collaborative effort. The bottom line is that the state now has one plan that coordinates all of our efforts versus a fragmented approach. As I mentioned earlier, business drives our focus, and a key part of that is making sure our educational system is producing young people with the skills and competencies they need to compete for in-demand jobs. And we want to make sure students and parents understand how they can move into those jobs. So with that, I'll turn it over to Carolyn to discuss one of our key strategies.
Thanks, Ryan. Could you go back one slide? The next slide, sorry, I had my slides mixed up there. So Career Connections, as Ryan mentioned, is the kindergarten through 12th grade initiative being led out of the Ohio Department of Education that really recognizes that we need to not only expand but enhance the opportunities that students have to link their learning to future career options. It really stems from, like I mentioned, kindergarten all the way through high school in a awareness, exploration, planning, and an eventual job seeking or transition into education and training. So you're going to see some of those emphasized in this slide. But also, if you go to the next slide, it really transpires in how these new policies are being implemented. If you think through the advising that we're providing students, and in Ohio, we really wanted to create some consistency in what students have access to. So we have state law that is helping to frame that and also expand so that advising begins earlier in middle grades, and we're specifically targeting some resources for students who may be at risk for dropping out. Ohio Means Jobs is one of the tools that the Office of Workforce Transformation is heavily supportive in coordinating across multiple agencies, as Ryan mentioned. And I'll talk to you in the next couple of slides what that looks like specifically for middle and high school students and then as well as the internship and community connectors grant, which promotes mentorships for students. So holistically, there's a lot of emphasis on advising and counseling, expanding the opportunities that students have to learn about in-demand jobs and engage with business and industry. And the piece that really shapes the effort overall is a framework. And I think Sharon mentioned, we've been doing a lot of this work around pathways for quite a while, so this isn't any new information, but for Ohio, it's really recognizing we need to again, streamline and build some consistency in the efforts that we are moving towards with career development, career exploration. So the Career Connections framework just wraps in a lot of those key areas that align with different grade levels. So in elementary school, it's developmentally appropriate to make sure that students are understanding the world of work and making those connections to folks in their community who are doing work in the companies that are most prominent. On the back side, or the second page of the Career Connections framework, really outlines for schools some of the activities that they might consider or that they already have in place and how that connects into the bigger picture to really build a continuum of experiences for students from kindergarten all the way through high school, and recognizing that we're building a foundation and those activities really grow in rigor as a student moves through middle and high school. So one of the key pieces that demonstrates what the pathway system looks like in Ohio are these career pathway templates or models that we've organized around Ohio's in-demand jobs. So you'll see the little orange thumbs up there within a couple of those boxes, and that recognizes that not only is it in-demand from an availability standpoint where we have a greater than average job posting, but also growth and wage. So we're doing not only a good kind of conversation piece for kids, but this is a demonstration of what an entire industry sector might look like, weaving in different credentials, experiential learning, showing the relationship and the variety of different occupations within an industry. So I tend to use the dental pathway as an example because it's most relatable for a lot of folks that don't maybe have this workforce development or career pathway background, especially our academic teachers who are just trying to maybe connect their classroom curriculum into different career fields or particular jobs. So it's a real accessible idea in terms of walking through what your experience to your local dentist might look like, the people that you encounter and engage with, and the different roles they have within an office. But it really highlights that there are varying levels of credentials. It's a snapshot of the labor market stats, so I'll say just at a glance. And then if you look at the second page of this pathway, it really would just give you an example of a program of study that a student in Ohio may start as early as 7th and 8th grade. We've been different menu options, if you will, related to dual enrollment in career technical education, so how they can earn some college credits while they're in middle and high school, and then carry that through into a post-secondary program if they aspire to go that route. It's a real good segue into the career exploration and planning system that Ohio is supporting called Ohio Means Jobs. So I use those pathway examples to really lure people in to do that next level of research to say, what will my own individual pathway look like? How do I build now, knowing what the menu is, my own individual plate, if you will? And we have a customized portal for K-12. What you'll see are the other audiences that really have tools available through this one-stop shop, if you will, from job seekers to employers, specific portals for veterans and Ohioans with disabilities, so that there are tailored menus of tools and resources for different roles. So the K-12 page really helps middle and high school students better understand what those options are and how to start planning for their future career as early as middle and high school. So the last piece I'll share with you within Ohio Means Jobs is what we call a backpack. And it's just basically the registration process so they can individualize the experience. And we have career interest surveys. We have, of course, all of the labor market information. They can research and save tons of different occupations, education and training required, as well as develop their own individual career plans based on different aspirations that they'll have. So we're really leveraging Ohio Means Jobs not only as a hub for a community, but a one-stop shop for middle and high school students to recognize what the opportunities are in Ohio and start building plans for their future earlier on.
Ryan and Carolyn, thank you so much. And I just want to acknowledge all the folks in the audience that have been sending in comments that they are very impressed with the comprehensive nature of Ohio's efforts. So you've made quite a few fans from the folks tuned in today, but we've also got some questions for you. Ryan, you talked about this, the combined state plan, and folks were specifically looking for specific examples of perhaps how you're encouraging collaboration across education and folks working in the job training arena.
Right. I think there's within our state plan, there's a heavy emphasis on industry sector partnerships and how can we get everybody in a community in the room together at the same time. And frankly, I don't think it's any more complex than that, but it's getting the business community, workforce professionals, K through 12, higher ed, all in the room together, working out how they can best build these pathways. I think the business community in Ohio has recognized that they need to be a part of building the future workforce. So we're seeing the business community really, really step up and engage the schools in terms of how they can partner with them to make sure that they have that future workforce that they need. So again, I would say the industry sector partnerships, that's probably one of the key initiatives that we have within the plan.
That's great. And Carolyn, perhaps you can take this question first, and Ryan, if you have something to add. But folks are curious whether or not the information on in-demand jobs is customized by region of the state, and particularly how that plays out in more rural areas with potentially fewer employers.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's one of the talking points that comes up in talking with teachers and counselors at schools. It's like, well, what does it look like for our county or our region? So Ryan can speak to the sweat, tears, and blood that's gone into really mining that data and the influences that kind of contribute to the overall behind-the-scenes piece, but it is broken down. It does disaggregate among the different regions throughout Ohio, like you said, based upon different characteristics and what might be more prominent in one area than the other.
Right. It was the in-demand occupation list. It was developed a couple years ago, and a survey went out to roughly 1,800 employers in the state. And they went to employers in targeted industries, and based on that feedback, they told us how many folks they needed to hire in the near term, and then kind of going out over the time horizon, how many folks they would need to hire, as well as what degrees are necessary, certifications, et cetera. And then we took all that data, developed this list of in-demand occupations, and that's where I roughly 85% of our job training funds today are directed to those in-demand occupations. And then to specifically answer your question, yes, you can. That data can be, you can drive down to the regional level to see what the in-demand occupations are in any given area of the state.
That's fantastic, and I can't imagine the challenges that you guys faced in building that system, but it is probably so helpful for students and their families. Question before we move on to our next presenter. Folks have had lots of questions about the mentoring opportunities that you mentioned. Carolyn, if you could address that first and talk a little bit about what that looks like in K-12 education. And then Ryan, if you could talk about specifically what's been going on in terms of mentoring from your employee or industry partners.
Sure. It's really a high priority from the funding standpoint as well. it's one thing to highlight that there's a great need there, but Ohio has recognized that we want to help stimulate that locally and put some local grant opportunities together. So the Community Connectors Grant is a competitive opportunity that collectively community as well as with their school partners apply for locally. We're still collecting data on the initial grantees, but there's been tremendous interest. There's been, anecdotally, we've seen a lot of media coverage on programs, and like Ryan mentioned, the partnerships are key to really driving those opportunities for kids, and just getting people in the same room talking has really produced some great value in the very early stages. The other piece was on internships, and again, it's an incentive program for businesses to really open their doors for high school students. And I'll say to this too that it's still early yet in data collection for both of those opportunities, so we don't yet have like an evaluation or reports published to really speak to the impact or the magnitude of reach, but tremendous support from our legislators and the governor's office just to really get some momentum going.
Right, Jennifer, and I would just add on to Carolyn's comments. So the Economic Development Agency for the state of Ohio, called the Ohio Development Services Agency, has a number of internship and career exploration programs that the state has funded to incent employers across the state to engage high school students as well as college-age students.
Well, thank you both so much. We are going to move on, but questions do keep coming in, and please know that we'll have another opportunity to ask questions to everyone towards the end of our session. But I'd like now to introduce Cynthia Bader, the Program Administrator for Linked Learning in Long Beach Unified School District. And I'm going to turn the microphone over to Cynthia.
Thank you, and hello, everyone. I'm going to start with a few key historical events that frame our work. In 2007, the Long Beach Unified School District Board of Education unanimously approved the Academic and Career Success Initiative, which established Long Beach Unified's commitment to college and career readiness. And then in 2008, Long Beach Unified School District, Long Beach City College, and California State University Long Beach signed the Long Beach College Promise, which extended the promise of a college education to every student in the Long Beach Unified School District, including free tuition for the first year at Long Beach City College, and priority admission to Cal State Long Beach. Then in 2014, the leaders of the three institutions reaffirmed their commitment to the college promise, and the mayor of Long Beach signed on as a fourth partner. In 2009, Long Beach Unified received a Linked Learning Implementation Grant, which is an educational approach that combines rigorous and relevant college prep academics with career-based professional skills to prepare students for college, career, and life. Linked learning allows students to apply classroom knowledge in real-world situations, and through integration of college career readiness practices, every student will be equipped with the necessary experience and training to succeed. Next slide, please. The initiative and the College Promise Partnership helped identify common student outcomes, secondary completion, post-secondary completion, industry credential completions, and ultimately entry into viable employment through integrated K-14-16 career pathways that align with the workforce needs in 15 industry sectors. Long Beach Unified adopted linked learning with the four components of integrated rigorous academics, career technical education, work-based learning, and comprehensive support services as its approach to achieving college and career readiness for all students. Next slide, please. Under the umbrella of a linked learning approach, there are different delivery models. In Long Beach, we have small linked learning career theme schools, which are small schools with less than 1,000 students and are typically focused on one or two industry sectors, such as engineering or engineering and biotechnology. We also have small linked learning career theme pathways in large comprehensive high schools. Each high school may have up to six different industry-related pathways. And then there are career academy pathways, which may be found in small or large high schools and are defined by specific metrics and criteria, such as California Partnership Academies, which are three-year industry-related programs structured as a school within a school, and the National Academy Foundation Academies, which are organized around one of five career themes: finance, hospitality and tourism, information technology, health sciences, or engineering. Next slide. In Long Beach, we have wall-to-wall linked learning career pathways in eight high schools. The district-wide choice process enables each student to choose a pathway based on their interest. Every student is enrolled in a pathway, including special education and English language learners. In total, we have 42 pathways representing 14 of the 15 California industry sectors. Three of them are CPAs, and four are NAF academies. Next slide. In order to achieve district-wide understanding, quality, and pathway alignment, it was necessary to develop a graduate profile that guides all of our work K-12. The graduate profile was developed with input from business partners and post-secondary partners and identifies the five most important attributes of a Long Beach High School graduate: college and career-ready scholar, critical and innovative problem solver, adaptable and productive citizen, ethical decision maker, and effective communicator and collaborator. Next slide, please. Additionally, each of the five attributes was defined and developed with the ELA and Literacy Common Core Standards, Standards for Mathematical Practice, and Standards for Career-Ready Practice. Professional development is anchored in these components and ensures that pathway student outcomes are standard-based and informed by the graduate profile. Next slide, please. Professional development is a key element for growing and sustaining linked learning, as well as ensuring quality and fidelity. Through our professional development offerings, we focus on developing quality linked learning instruction in the classroom by focusing on effective teaching practices, academic and technical content, Common Core implementation, and project-based learning, all infused with that industry theme, the real-world application, integrating the curriculum, and work-based learning experiences. Grade-level teams, as well as our site administrators and counselors, attend multiple professional development trainings. And the linked learning approach is embedded into the beginning teacher's support and assessment induction program. Next slide, please. State policy, legislations, and resources have played a key role in supporting and accelerating linked learning at the district level, as well as strengthening post-secondary and employer partnerships. A few examples shown on this slide are the SB 1070 legislation that improves K-16 linkages through articulation, dual enrollment, and pathway industry partnership alignment, and by developing career technical education pathways between high schools and community college. The Perkins Career Technical Education Grant supports academic programs that prepare students for careers in emerging and established professions with both academic and technical education, and may lead to technical skill, credential, certificate, or degree. Legislation AB 790 called for the establishment of linked learning pilot programs that would be used to assess how linked learning can be expanded to schools across the state. The CTE Transition Grant focuses on five objectives: outreach, career exploration, articulation, concurrent enrollment, credit by exam, and work-based learning. It requires designated community colleges to fund activities related to helping pathway students transition from secondary to post-secondary education and on to the world of work. The CT Incentive Grant, the state of California has set aside $900 million in matching grant funds. The goal is to provide secondary students with the knowledge and skills necessary to transition to employment and post-secondary education. The grant supports the establishment of new CTE programs and support for ongoing programs. California Career Pathways Trust. The state of California set aside $500 million to be allocated for the development of work-based learning infrastructure, innovative regional partnerships for career pathway support, and the expansion and improvement of career pathway programs statewide. Long Beach Unified School District joined the Long Beach City College Consortium in a $15 million three-year California Career Pathways Trust grant focused on increasing alignment and pathways for regional students who want to pursue careers in advanced manufacturing and engineering. Academic programs must be connected with business in the region to prepare students for jobs. Additionally, Long Beach City College and Cal State University Long Beach partnered with Long Beach Unified in a $6 million three-year California Career Pathways Trust grant focused on advancing and increasing alignment and pathways for local students who want to pursue careers in healthcare. The Governor's Innovation Award, Long Beach College Promise received a $5 million award that recognizes innovations in higher education that smooth academic transition points for students moving from elementary and secondary education to post-secondary institutions. AB 288 is legislation that facilitates the development and promotion of K-12 and community college dual enrollment programs. It authorizes a school district and a community college district to enter into a college and access pathway partnership with the goal of developing a seamless pathway from high school to community college for CTE or preparation for transfer or helping high school students achieve college and career readiness. And the California Local Control Accountability Plan establishes greater transparency and accountability for school districts. It incentivizes schools and districts to pay attention to learning opportunities and outcomes aligned to the 8 priority areas. And it includes the expectation that college and career readiness indicators will be included. Over a third of the LCAP goals in the Long Beach Plan relate to an emphasis on linked learning and linked learning certification. Next slide, please. Success of our efforts since 2009 with the adoption of the College and Career Readiness Initiative, the College Promise, and the Linked Learning are shown here on this slide. Since 2009-10, our graduation rate has increased from 75.9 to 81%. Our dropout rate fell from 13.2% to 11.6%. Students completing the UC A through G requirements, which are the minimum subject requirements for entrance into the University of California and California State University, rose from 36.8 to 49%, while scholarships earned by seniors rose from $51.5 million to $96 million. Additionally, students who enrolled in post-secondary education within 1 year of graduation is currently at 75%, and within 2 years, it is at 80%. Next slide, please. And so, with the state policy support and additional resources that support linked learning pathways, we are poised to continue the work of college and career readiness for all students. Much of the success is due to strong partnerships with our post-secondary, city, and employer partners who are committed to this work. Since 2007, all efforts have been towards these outcomes, regardless of fiscal conditions such as the Great Recession. Due to increased support from these initiatives, state policy, resources, and strengthened partnerships, there is increased momentum around pathway work in Long Beach. And so with that, I thank you, and I turn this back to Jennifer.
Thank you so much, Cynthia. This is really fabulous to hear about all the work that you've been doing and the continued path that you've been on since beginning the journey of developing linked learning career pathways in Long Beach Unified. I want to thank the audience for continuing to send your questions in. We're going to pause here for a few for Cynthia, but promise that we will ask some of the questions which you've brought in at the end to all of our presenters. Cynthia, you mentioned a lot of STEM pathways as you were describing some of the pathways that you have in Long Beach Unified. Do you also have pathways that are more focused on the arts or the liberal arts? And if so, could you talk about some of those pathways?
Sure. As I mentioned, we have 14 of the 15 industry sectors covered by the different pathways. We have digital arts, we've got media, we've got arts and entertainment, we have our Renaissance is a small school for the arts. We have our Justice Academy. We have our Public Service Academy. We have our Green Academy. We have so we really cover the broad spectrum of all of the industry sectors.
That's great. And it sounds like, you know, given that they're aligned with the pathways in the state, they're probably the jobs that are available in your area as well.
Yes, we have really aligned when we set up to do the pathways. We look at our not only the state labor market, our regional local market, and then the data that we can also collect from the EMSI data, which really gives us the labor market information within the footprint of our community college.
Fabulous. So one final question before we move on to hear about the Career Pathways Facilitator's Guide. Within the pathways, you mentioned that you're able to serve all types of students, both students with disabilities and English language learners. Could you talk about some of the supports that are in place for those students? Are they receiving extra guidance in terms of career pathway selection? Are they receiving extra supports beyond what perhaps their IEP or other special services might do? And what do those look like in Long Beach?
Sure. Well, first of all, just the nature of selecting a pathway and cohorting, the students being cohorted into pathways, the teachers sharing the same population of students, they're really able to give targeted intervention and targeted support right away with lifetime interventions. We have a new data dashboard that gives teachers easy and immediate access to student data. We have AVID as a strategy for students. We've got after-school programs. We have our transition partnership program that serves students with disabilities through pre-employment training and career readiness development. We have specialized 7 through 12 career readiness program for our special education students that helps them sort of determine where they might want to go and sign up for at the high school. And then they put together a six-year plan for their 7 to 12.
Fabulous. Thanks so much. And I'm going to move us on, but again, we will get to your questions at our final Q&A slot during the webinar. And I'd like to turn the microphone over to Jamar and David from the CCRS Center at AIR.
Thank you, Jennifer. I'm Jamar Nellums, and I'm a Senior Technical Assistant Consultant with the CCRS Center at AIR.
And hi, my name is David Blumenthal. I'm a researcher also with the CCRS Center.
And as Laura mentioned at the start of the webinar, the CCRS Center provides technical assistance support as part of a federally funded technical assistance network. And our charge is to support states in the design, implementation, and continuous improvement of their college and career readiness initiatives. The resource we want to introduce you to today is our newly designed and newly released Designing a Career Pathway System, a framework for state education agencies. The resource provides an overview of the key elements of a pathway system, along with guidance on a process for designing a system that's tailored to a state's individual needs and priorities. Although in the title and its initial design is specifically for state education agencies, it can also be used by local education agencies as well. And the facilitation of the process that's outlined in the resource isn't limited to an educational agency or government staff. So for example, it could be delivered by or co-facilitated with other educational stakeholders, for example, district staff, industry representatives, post-secondary partners, representatives from CTE, Career and Technical Education, and professional organizations, among others. And those are also some good examples of the potential participants who could be involved in the process that's outlined, as well as community-based organizations, parents, adult education representatives, and local and state policymakers, and the workforce development sector. The resource also recognizes the different roles a participant may have to help support the development of a career pathway system. So, for example, a legislator's role in decision-making from a policy perspective, or a participant's role as a connector across various initiatives. The framework is divided into four chapters, and in a moment, David's going to provide more detail on each chapter's content. But structurally speaking, and you heard Laura refer to this a little earlier, there's a facilitator guide with chapter objectives, a slide presentation with facilitation notes, planning activities which involve the facilitator and supporting staff, and group activities to help participants reach their intended objectives. And then lastly, there's supplementary resources and an additional information to support both the facilitator and the participants' contextual knowledge and understanding of the process. This slide provides a good visual example of one of the pages from the facilitator's guide. And as you can see, there are some helpful icons that serve as signposts throughout each chapter. And then on the right-hand side of your slide, this is an example to help the facilitator visualize one of the group activities, what it should look like. The framework structure provides the user the option of tailoring the framework to address their state or district-specific needs. So this is something Laura also alluded to a little earlier. Any one of the chapters could be facilitated as a standalone based on where a state might be in the development of their career pathway system. In addition, the content and activities in the resource can be adjusted depending on the participants that are engaged in the process, or adjusted based on a state's policy or programmatic landscape. This could be particularly useful for states that are already in the process of designing or implementing a career pathways, as the framework can help enhance or refine efforts that are already underway. The resources and tools in this framework don't provide any particular career pathway model or don't promote any particular career pathways model or initiative. It also doesn't address teaching or learning strategies or curriculum resources, but the resource does provide guidance from the beginning stages of stakeholder identification and information gathering all the way through the design of a pathway system and into continuous improvement and sustainability planning. Now David's going to provide an overview of the four chapters by title, and then we'll be glad to take any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Jamar. Let's take a quick look at the chapters in the Designing a Career Pathway System framework. It's organized into four chapters, and we'll take a closer look at each, but I would like to point out that the facilitator guide is not meant to be taken in sequential order, just reiterating what Jamar said, but rather the individual state or organization using the guide can determine where they want to start and where they want to stop. Great, so here's chapter one. The goal of this chapter is to identify and engage key stakeholders and define the goals of a career pathway system. Within the chapter, there are activities to implement a kickoff meeting, clarify the stakeholder roles and responsibilities, identify commitment to the process, and build the stakeholder knowledge and define their goals and priorities for the career pathways elements. In Chapter 2, the overall goal is to understand the state's career pathways landscape, including policies and programs already in place, as well as the growing industries and occupations that will need qualified workers in the future. This chapter includes a mapping inventory of career readiness policies and programs, and it provides guidance to start conducting a labor market gap analysis. The overall goal of Chapter 3 is to learn about the key knowledge and competencies and the wage earnings for industry experts, interpret the career pathway system data, and develop a career pathway system framework plan. The activities and guidance include completing and reviewing the labor market gap analysis, identifying experts from the target industries, and prioritizing industry focus and developing industry-specific pathway system. The goal of Chapter 4 is to implement and evaluate the development of the career pathway system framework, identify short and long-term metrics for evaluating the success of the initiative, and engage stakeholders in the implementation process. The project team identifies the metrics for success and develops a plan for implementing the career pathway system. The facilitator can also lead the project team through a reflection exercise focused on the implementation of the developed system. The framework, including the facilitator guide, PowerPoint presentation slides, and handouts, is all available on the CCR Center website at the address you see on your screen now. On the right-hand side of the screen, you should see a view of what it looks like on the website. To navigate to the page, go to the Technical Assistance menu and select Career Pathways Modules, and you'll be able to navigate between any of the four chapters to find all the resources that are associated with the resource. At this point in time, we're looking for interested states or regional groups that would like assistance with designing and implementing their career pathway systems and who would like to pilot the framework with us. In addition, and as always, the CCRS Center is available to provide guidance and technical assistance on career pathways and other college and career readiness components. If you'd like to get in contact with us, here's our contact information. You can email Jamar or myself, or just give us a call.
Thanks, Stephen and Jamar. This is a great presentation and such a great tool. We're going to just ask a couple of questions of you about this tool, and then we'll open it up to some of the questions that have come in for all of our panelists. You mentioned that specifically that the chapters do not need to go in any order, but folks are wondering why you selected the order that you did for the chapters.
I can take that question, Laura, if you're on the phone and you want to take it, that's fine as well. But basically, the order that we design this is the most sequential and logical, and the one that we find has worked the best for those that have successfully implemented a career pathway system.
Thanks so much. And as Jamar and David both mentioned, the CCRS Center is looking for partners, and you can contact them, and I will put up everyone's contact information here on the slides as well. So if you're interested in that, here's the folks that you should be contacting. And if you did ask a question, we will absolutely put you in touch with them as well. We've had a lot of questions come in around what you mentioned going on in Chapter 2, particularly around the labor market gap analysis. And so, Jamar and David, could you mention some of the sources that folks could potentially use to get some of that labor market information to help in the selection of career pathways?
Sure thing, Jennifer. Jamar, I hope you don't mind me jumping in on this one. It's a
Not
bit of
all.
A passion for me, given my background in the workforce development community. A lot of states already have labor market information that they provide at either a regional level or at a statewide level. So we help identify, we help states that are interested in developing career pathway systems identify where they can find local or state-specific labor market information. And we're also familiar with a lot of different resources. One of the other presenters from Long Beach Community College mentioned an excellent source of labor market information, EMSI, which is a provider of localized labor market information. And there's also the U.S. Census Bureau and just a lot of different places where this information might exist and where you can access it. And our role is to help states identify where they can get data quickly and to integrate that into their design of the career pathway systems.
Great, thanks so much. And one question for you guys again, I know you mentioned it before, but just to be clear, although the tool was designed with a state audience in mind, is it adaptable for district level use and or other groups? And if so, who are those other groups? Jamar, why don't you take that question?
Yes, it is adaptable for other groups. So, for example, some of the ones that I mentioned earlier, community-based organizations, industry representatives, or folks that you have from professional organizations. For example, if you have a CTE organization that you have access to, also representatives from the career and technical education field. Any of those are good examples. And actually, in our first chapter, we list a variety of stakeholders that that might be good to be involved in the process and are also, depending on their background and their expertise, could be excellent as facilitators or co-facilitators of the process and the development of the pathway system.
Great, thanks so much. So I want to open it up to some questions that we have for all of our panelists, and I'm going to do my best to list an order in which folks can address the question, but to folks on the phone, please jump in if you have something to add. To our presenters, I mean, please jump in if you have something to add. There have been a significant number of questions about supports for particularly students with disabilities and what that looks like in terms of developing career pathways. Sharon, can you talk a little bit about some of the tools that the department has developed, particularly around supporting students with disabilities? And then Ryan and Carolyn in Ohio, can you talk about that as well?
So, you know, a lot of our documents at the national level so far have not been designed for individual student populations. So, you know, we don't really have anything yet that's specifically geared toward students with disabilities, although it's kind of addressed within the broader framework of the key element. So it's one of the populations that as a state, a regional, and the local level, if they are looking at designing their programs, that they would have to do that kind of assessment of who are the partners that are there, what resources are available, what types of supports are there, again, what kind of stakeholders have to be at the table, what are the correct standards when they're working with employers, especially what are the supports that can be provided. So, you know, those topics are addressed within the broader context of the deliverables, the documents that we have, but we don't have anything specifically designed yet for individual student populations.
Ryan and Carolyn?
Sure. So Ryan mentioned that the state level is really focused on several agencies collaborating. And, you know, one of the key efforts is to reduce unnecessary duplication. So OOD?
Opportunities.
The Opportunities for Ohioans with Disabilities agency is really strongly partnered with the Ohio Department of Education to make sure there's a collaborative approach to supporting students with disabilities who also qualify for transition services. And then kind of the Streamlined Career Connections initiative, the policy recognizes what we're calling a student success plan, and we've had several conversations within the agency about how does that complement the individualized education plan or the IEP rather than create duplication or, again, unnecessary redundancies. So we're recognizing where we can maximize efforts by partnering intentionally. And Ohio Means Jobs is definitely accessible to students. Again, you know, you may need some support depending on different abilities, but it's certainly a resource that is supporting IEP and transition planning work.
Great, thanks so much. And for the CCRS Center team, does anyone want to comment on how the guide could potentially be customizable to serving that population or other resources that you might have in terms of career pathways for that population?
Sure, this is Laura. I would say a couple of things. The first is that the tool can already be customized, and folks that are interested in doing so can contact the CCRS Center and request the Word version of these materials. We also encourage within the group of stakeholders in Chapter 1, when bringing that group together, that you include a pretty wide net of folks that represent different interests in different student groups, including students with disabilities. And I would also encourage folks to think about, as they go through the resource, in each chapter where they can be inclusive of students with those needs. For example, Chapter 2 in mapping and assessing the policies, programs, and resources that are available to support this work, there may be resources that are specific to the needs of students with disabilities that can be utilized to promote career pathways specific to students with disabilities. So it really depends on the state's context, but the tool is built so that it can be customized for each state's needs.
Fabulous. Thanks so much. So we've had a number of questions, and I'm hoping that everyone on the panel will be willing to address this. But first, I see that Cynthia would like to add something around students with disabilities. So Cynthia, please.
Yes, thank you. I think someone mentioned sort of the sharing of the resources, and a couple of things that we are trying to do is to sort of cross those silos, and our special education teachers also attend all of our performance mapping and a lot of the same integration professional developments that the non-special education teachers participate in. And we're also really trying to partner with our career readiness programs, sharing the resources for career readiness trainings, sharing internship opportunities, and really trying to bring all of the different silos together to work as one.
Thanks so much. That was really helpful. So like I said, I have one final question, which I hope everyone will address. And Sharon, I'm going to ask you to take it first, then the team from Ohio, then Cynthia, and then finally the CCRS Center team. Folks are really interested, Sharon, if specifically you can address whether or not Perkins funds can be used for career exploration activities, particularly around the selection of pathways for students. And then the Ohio team and Cynthia in Long Beach, could you talk specifically about what your career exploration activities look like in middle school? We focused a lot on what happens in high school, but can you talk about what goes on in middle school? And then finally for the CCRS Center team, can you talk about specifically how you envision role of counselors participating both in using the facilitator's guide and then in communicating and develop and disseminating the career pathways. So Sharon?
Sure, thank you for the question. So funds are absolutely allowable for career exploration under the Carl D. Perkins Career and Technical Education Act. The only real prohibition we have is that funds have to be used above the seventh grade level. So certainly in the middle school as well as in high school and beyond, it's certainly allowable, and a lot of states have built into their systems opportunities for students to explore careers through a whole variety of means, whether it's all types of things that are being done in school to, work-based learning opportunities that they can participate on to explore their areas of interest. So that's absolutely an allowable activity. I would also want to mention that our office right now is in the final phases of what's called a Reach Higher app challenge, which we are in the process of developing an app that students could use on their iPhone where they could actually go in and customize their interests in career pathways and get linked to education and training that's appropriate along their career path, get labor market information, find schools and programs that are appropriate for them. And again, this could be something that students can download. And I love the idea of Ohio's backpack. I mean, also being able to have that right in a student's hand on the thing that they use most, which is their iPhones or their portable devices, is something that we're doing. So right now we're in the process of developing some semifinalists, and after that those folks will go through a series of refining of their apps, and hopefully we'll be able to announce something later this year with a final app. So yes, career exploration is a central part of the Perkins Act, and we are doing the best that we can do to try to get that down to the student level and give them the information they need to make better choices for themselves.
Thanks so much, Carolyn and Ryan.
Yeah, so middle grades career exploration is increasingly important because we're recognizing we really have to expose kids to a lot of the in-demand industries earlier on. Later in high school, it's just too late. They don't have enough opportunity or time in all of the hustle and bustle of high school to really try different things on and to engage in a lot of those opportunities. So middle grades, we have scaled up by reaching further down in middle grades our career technical education programs. So that's a huge effort to get connections in classrooms, to leverage partners with businesses. I mentioned the mentorship piece earlier. Ohio Means Jobs is hugely involved in a lot of the awareness and the exploration pieces. Sharon mentioned the backpack, and that really is the mechanism for driving that continuous planning and recognizing that student interests do change over time as they get more experiences. So whether it's going out to businesses, we have a lot of businesses who are coming out to schools, dedicating some time, they're bringing different equipment, materials, or activities that kids can really try on while they're still at school, and you name it, and I'm sure there's a school in Ohio that's trying it.
Fabulous. Cynthia, can you talk a little bit about middle school efforts in Long Beach?
Sure. We have a lot going on with our in our middle schools. In several of our middle schools, we have begun to put in the Project Lead the Way Gateway to Technology programs. We're doing launch in our elementary schools. I'm really trying to give students sort of that hands-on experience earlier in their work. We also have Pathways Scholar program in all of our middle schools that really offers students the ability to take a look and do career exploration. And we have a Skills for Success grant through the federal government, which is really looking at the effect of metacognitive skills of career development and other things leading towards high school success. We have extensive use of our graduate profile, and within that, a work-based learning continuum that we've taken down to the elementary school, actually, really working with teachers, doing teacher externships, and showing ways that teachers can embed career readiness and exploration into their curriculum. Again, at the middle school level, in a partnership with Fresno, we've developed a career exploration dashboard platform online where students can go in and do assessments, learn about the different careers. And then we're also, this spring, we'll be having our first middle school career fair for seventh graders, who will bring in all of our local employers and businesses and have sort of hands-on demonstrations, workshops, different things for the students to attend, but at the same time have sort of notification of which of those industries we have pathways for and what high schools has those pathways, so that students can actually in seventh grade begin thinking about, oh, I really liked this, I could go to this school in their pathway. So really starting to get them to think earlier about what their interests are.
Thanks so much. And for the CCRS Center team, can you particularly talk about the role of counseling and the way in which they can participate, counselors generally can participate in the development of career pathways?
Sure. Thanks, Jennifer. We developed the facilitator's guide for someone at the educational agency, and it really can be the state or the local education agency, and it is really role neutral. And the reason that we did that is because the facilitator ideally would be a person who has a lot of knowledge about the existing curriculum, courses, as well as additional supports and work-based learning opportunities that students really need in order to create a coherent sequence of courses and supports in order to get their, to complete their pathways program. And it would certainly be the college counselor at the local level. Because that person would have a great deal of that knowledge. So we do think that counselors would be an ideal person to process at the district level.
Fabulous. Thanks so much. And I want to thank our audience for sticking with us as we ran a few minutes over. This was a really great presentation. I want to extend my thanks to all the panelists for your hard work and really great presentations. And, of course, to our audience for sticking with us. As you exit today,